Boy Child was written by Jester Hairston. Jester Hairston was an actor, a singer, a choir director, a music composer, arranger of many spirituals. Probably his most famous song is Amen from the movie Lilies of the Field. Mary Boy Child.
Hark now, hear the angels sing, new kings born today, and man will live forevermore because of Christmas Day.
This Friday, Alberta, our church secretary, got exposed to COVID from her grandson this past week, at the end of the week. Because of the holidays, she was not able to get in.
It is a responsibility. God's word makes the winds blow and the water flow. Jesus Christ is God's word to us and for us.
Receive the word and believe the good news. Know you are children of God, born of the Spirit.
The word came flesh to dwell with humanity. Grace and forgiveness are lavished upon us.
Be radiant in appreciation of God's goodness. Hear the word of God and declare it to others.
In Christ we have obtained an inheritance. Spiritual blessings are abundantly available to us.
Please stand as you are able for our first hymn, number 12, in the hymnal, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise.
Look upon your infirm creatures, broken and bereaved, with compassion and consolation. We view your world with unseen eyes. We listen to the cries of your hurting people with ears that do not hear and hearts that do not feel their plight. The wind blows among us, but we do not discern your spirit. You offer wisdom and insight, but we reject your counsel. You present to us gospel of salvation, but we turn away from its saving grace. O God, help us change the direction of our lives so that we may act like your children and reflect your love into the world.
Word made flesh in Jesus is for us. God's gift of new life is ever valuable. God grants us power to change, if that is our sincere desire. The Holy Spirit is at work in our midst. We are destined to live as children of God. Let us open our eyes and stop our ears and live with empathy for all. With faith, we can live our beliefs, praising God who blessed us in Christ. Let us sing glory to God.
Glory be to God.
praise for the spiritual blessings in Christ. Praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. For he chose us in him before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. In love, he predestined us for adoption to sonship through Jesus Christ, in accordance with his pleasure and will, to the praise of his glorious grace, which he has freely given us in the one he loves. In him, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us. With all wisdom and understanding, he made known to us the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ, to be put into effect when the times reach their fulfillment, to bring unity to all things in heaven and on earth under Christ. In him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we, who were first to put our hope in Christ, might be for the praises of his glory. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who are God's possession, to the praise of his glory.
Hear God's word for us on this day. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of people. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all people might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testifies concerning him. He cries out, saying, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me has surpassed me, because he was before me.' From the fullness of his grace we have all received one blessing after another. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only, who is at the Father's side, has made him known." May God bless to our understanding this reading from God's holy word. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. Well, there you have it. It is one of the single greatest texts in all of Scripture. One theologian likens it to an overture to a symphony, or a preface to the greatest story ever told. In the beginning was the Word. The last time we heard those words go all the way back to the book of Genesis, Chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In Jesus Christ, God is inaugurating a new creation. This story is about three people. First and foremost, it is a story about Jesus. In the beginning was the Word, the Logos. Greek, and that word is Jesus. This story affirms the full deity of Jesus. He was there when God made everything. He was there from the very beginning. And this is the point of departure for the three major world religions that all trace their roots back to Abraham. Did God really go down so low as to become a real human being? God is just too great to do this, says Islam in reverence. God is so great that he was willing to do this, says the Christian faith. He became Emmanuel. God with us. Several modern translations of the Bible have different ways of phrasing this. He moved into the neighborhood, says one translation. Another one says he pitched his tent among us. He camped out with us. Kind of emphasized the temporary nature of Jesus being with us on earth in bodily form. Theologian Gail O'Day says that the Word becoming flesh is the decisive event in human history. It changes God's relationship to us and our relationship to God. The incarnation means that human beings can see and hear and know God in ways never before possible. In Trafalgar Square in London, there is a high tower in the middle of the square with a statue of Lord Admiral Nelson at the pinnacle. The only problem with the monument is that this statue is so high up in the air that the people can't really see the admiral to see what he looks like from down on the ground. So eventually they decided to solve this issue by building a replica of what's at the peak of the monument and bring it down to eye level so people could see what Lord Admiral Nelson actually looked like. One pastor says that he thinks this is kind of a little bit like what God did for the human race in Jesus. The high, invisible God came down, eye level Jesus, his son, so that we can see what God is like. Jesus is life, the light of the world. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it or understood it, depending on which translation you read. If you use the word overcome, that implies that the light has done battle with the darkness and won out. If you use instead the word understood, it means that the darkness has not really understood what the light brings to the world and how it can make a difference. Either translation really works just fine. But note also that it says the light shines in the darkness. Present tense. It is still shining. This is also a story about John. He is called John the Baptist in the other gospel accounts, but not so much here. In John's gospel, which is a different John altogether, the role of John the Baptist is not so much that of a baptizer as it is that of a witness. In the other gospel accounts, the word to bear witness or to testify is only used a couple of times. In John's gospel, it's used 33 times. To bear witness is a really big deal in John's gospel, and John is the prime example of that. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning the light, so that all might believe through him. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. John makes it clear that the one to come after him, Jesus, was superior in every way. John seeks no disciples of his own. The guys that acknowledged him, that were attracted to him, those who tried to ascribe to him messianic power and status, he pointed them away from himself. "Don't look at me," he said. "Look to Jesus, the one who reveals the grace and truth of God, the Son of God, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world." That's the greatness of John, that he rejects the all too flattering but false ascriptions of his eager disciples and gives testimony to another, to the one true light of the world. John is a witness, nothing more. He is also, though, nothing less than a witness. He is only a voice, but he does have a voice. His testimony has divine approval and authorization. Jesus later calls him a burning and shining lamp. And he was such, and as such, he was precisely because he was a witness, not to himself, but to the light of the world. The light that he gave was not his own, but a pale reflection, kind of like the moon is a reflection of the sun's light. John was a reflection of Jesus' greater and brighter light. And his word of testimony is but an echo of Jesus' words, an echo of a greater and more powerful word. Yet the pale reflection and the echo certainly have their role to play in God's purposes. It's precisely as a witness that John is crucial and indispensable. There's a joy and a freedom in that role of being a witness when our only burden is simply and persistently to give testimony, as John did, to God's word. We're now to the third person that this story is about, and that person is you. But I don't say you in the plural sense of that word, but in the singular sense of that word, because if I say bearing witness is up to you, plural, then you tend to think, well, bearing witness, that's probably somebody else's job in the church, not my job. I've got another role to play. But when we use you as singular you, it means each one of us has a role to play. Each one of us is to bear witness in whatever ways that we can. We tend to ask, what can I do to witness to Jesus Christ as the light of the world, rather than what should somebody else be doing? Back in World War I, Martin Niemöller was a soldier in the German army. After World War I finished, he went to seminary and became a Lutheran pastor. And he became one of the leaders against Hitler and the rise of Nazism. So in 1937, not surprisingly, he went to a concentration camp, and he remained there until 1945 when he was released. Not long before he died in 1984, he was in the United States and gave a lecture at a seminary to the students who were gathered there. And he told them about this dream that he kept having. And in the dream, Hitler was standing before the judgment seat of God. And God asked, "Before I pass final judgment, are there any words you would like to say in your defense?" Hitler replied, "I never once heard the true gospel message." Niemöller told the students that were gathered in that lecture hall that he was haunted by that dream. There is no doubt, remarks one pastor, that growing up in Austria and Germany, Hitler had heard words spoken about God. He had, without a doubt, heard words spoken about God in Bible readings and in sermons and in prayers and in hymns. Yet it's entirely possible that even though Hitler heard hundreds and probably even thousands of words about God during his lifetime, those words had never led him to encounter for himself the one true God, namely, Jesus Christ. He needed someone to be a witness, not just to point to themselves as an example of what a great person looks like, but to point beyond themselves the role John played, to point beyond himself to Jesus Christ. And that's the role that each one of us is to play as well, to bear witness to Jesus Christ in whatever ways we can, to bear witness to the one who is full of grace and truth and who makes all the difference in the world. Amen. Our hymn is number 124, Still, Still, Still. Those who are able, please stand. Sister's brother-in-law, also some health issues with oxygen, is in intensive care right now. So those are our prayer concerns. Does anyone have any updates on folks or anyone else to add?
I have a good friend that lives in Boulder, Colorado, and they were spared by about a mile and a half.
Oh, my God.
Spared from the fire. So to keep that city.
So we have Boulder, Colorado, with the wildfires that hit, and Lisa had a friend whose house was spared by just about a mile and a half, so grateful for that. Any others? Okay, we will keep all of these folks in our communion prayers this morning. And then we continue just to spend the offering time with some meditation. The collection plates are up front and in the back. And we do so this morning with Jesus' words from Matthew's gospel in mind. Jesus said, freely you have received, freely give. So let us think about the ways in which we may give of ourselves.
Thank you.
and also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right
we to give our thanks and praise.
O holy God, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, with joy we give you thanks and praise. In sending us your Son Jesus to be born of Mary, your word became flesh, and we have seen a new and radiant vision of your glory. His name is above every name. He is light in our darkness, the Prince of Peace, and Savior of all. For in him we are delivered from sin and given the power to become your children. How wonderful are your ways, Almighty God. How marvelous is your name, O Holy One. You alone are God. Therefore, with apostles and prophets and that great crowd of witnesses who live for you beyond all time and space, we lift our hearts in joyful praise. We praise you, most holy God, for sending your only Son, Jesus, to live among us, full of grace and truth. He made you known to all who received him. Sharing our joy and sorrow, he healed the sick and was a friend of sinners. Obeying you, he took up his cross and died that we might live. We praise you that he overcame death and is risen to rule the world. He is still the friend of sinners. We trust him to overcome every power that can hurt or divide us, and believe that when he comes in glory, we will celebrate victory with him. Gracious God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us, that this bread and this cup may be for us the body and blood of our Lord, and that we and all who share this feast may be one with Christ and he with us. Fill us with eternal life, that with joy we may be his faithful people until we feast with him in glory. We pray this morning especially for Sylvia, Savannah, Nikki and Rick, Joan, John, Evelyn, Jim, Art, Allison, Joan, Lucinda, and John, for Maxine and George, and for people in our church family, especially today, Dan and Jenny. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come,
thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen. Our Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed and arrested, took bread and blessed it and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, as I am ministering in his name, now give it to you, saying, This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. This is the body of Christ, given for you. In the same way, Jesus took the cup, and after he had given thanks, as has been done in his name, he gave it to his disciples, saying, This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for many for the forgiveness of sins. All of you drink of it. This is the blood of Christ shed for you. These are the gifts of God for the people.
Thank you.
your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you always.